Hello everyone. Today we are bringing you exclusive insights directly from the COP16 in Colombia. The COP16 is the first big milestone after the COP15, which happened 2 years ago, where countries agreed on the Kunming Montreal Global Biodiversity Framework. Some therefore call this the implementation COP, where countries are supposed to be showing real progress. I'm excited to be joined by Aleksandar Rankovik. He's a lecturer at Sciences Po and HEC in Paris, and he's also the co-founder and co-CEO of the think tank, the Common Initiative. Aleksandar is attending the COP16 in person, and he will be sharing insights with us on what's happening on the ground. Thank you for joining us, Aleksandar.
Hi, Julie. Thank you.
There is a lot of attention on biodiversity right now. As discussion at the COP16 unfold, how do you assess the current level of global ambition?
Well, that's a very good question. The COP just finished this morning after almost 24 hours of delay, and actually it hasn't finished. It was just pause, I would say. The meeting was adjourned. The COP will be really finished only in a few months, most likely in Bangkok. As we were entering the final topics, but actually the toughest ones of the negotiations, there were not enough people in the room anymore because lots of delegates had to fly back home, and lots of smaller delegations in particular didn't have the means, the financial resources to lose their plane ticket. And so they had to fly back. So at some point, a delegate has to count how many countries were left in the room. The quorum wasn't met, and so the meeting was adjourned. That's an anecdote, but that tells you where we are, is that we need to suspend the biggest summit in 2 years because lots of people just don't have the money to postpone or buy another plane ticket for this issue. And those are not like individuals. When I say people, those are governments. So it's an anecdote, but that tells you also where we are on the bigger picture of ambition on biodiversity beyond, you know, discourses or the impression of having lots of movement on the topic.
Will this COP16 be the implementation COP? Can you tell us about the overall atmosphere at the conference and what's being prioritized in the discussion so far?
And yes, Cali indeed was supposed to be the implementation COP after Montreal under the Chinese presidency 2 years ago that gave, you know, the adoption of the Kunming Montreal framework with the 23 targets, the four goals for 2050. Now, 2 years later, the question was to assess where we are and also put in place and finalize the tools, different metrics, but also the whole mechanics of how countries are going to use these metrics to hold each other accountable. And there was the burning issue of finance and of, I would say, a topic that is closely linked to finance, which is the question of the use of the benefits, the sharing, sorry, of the benefits arising from the use of genetic resources, and more specifically the digitalized version of genetic resources. So basically, when you have some form of genetic information that is used from plants or animals for economic purposes.
With the US elections approaching, how could the outcome influence international biodiversity commitments?
This is a great question. Well, the US is not a party at the CBD, it's an observer. So it's not going to necessarily change directly the mood in the room during negotiations. However, the US is a major contributor to multilateral finance and also bilateral finance for biodiversity. So I would say that changes in US policy on that front can have an effect on the global conversation. And of course, the geopolitical mood can also be quite influenced by the outcomes of the US election.
Now, moving from global ambitions to national ambitions, signatories of the GBF were required to develop national strategies before the COP16. So what are the major obstacles for countries?
There was just about 30 countries who had submitted their revised NBSAP, National Biodiversity Strategy and Action Plan. About 100 had submitted just national targets without the bigger strategy package on how to achieve them. A big reason for countries struggling to update their NBSAPs is the lack of human capacity. You need to have a lot of consultations with lots of different actors. That takes time, capacity, that takes money, sorry to say it this way, because you also need resources to organize these events. And also sometimes you just need more data and etc.
Funding is a crucial element for implementation of the Global Biodiversity Framework. So what are the expectations for financing biodiversity?
So yes, for these different reasons, this is why finance was one of the biggest topics on the table, the big topic on the table at COP16. It's because we know from different assessments, some give a little bit more, some give a little bit less, that we need to mobilize about $1 trillion a year by 2030 if we are to implement the Kunming Montreal Framework. The acknowledged financing gap in the Kunming Montreal Framework is of $700 billion a year to be filled. So this is why during the negotiations there was lots of tension around this issue, and this is how the negotiations ended. So we ended precisely at the moment where discussions were starting on that front, because it took a lot of discussions backstage. Now the question from now to the next meeting, so when we will formally close the COP and come back to these topics in a few months, well, you know, whether we will manage to indeed get that interesting package, because without that, it's sure that we will not have the implementation that we need.
A lot of attention is also being placed on nature-based solutions and biodiversity credits. So how are these mechanisms being received at COP16? And what are the main points of debate?
Because we're blocked, I would say, on structural reforms and on deeper reforms of economic sectors, we tend to have hope in new tools and approaches, which can be part of the solution, but that will not do the bulk of the work. So while there's been quite some agitation around, these new forms of offsettings that are not calling themselves this way, around biodiversity credits or certificates or nature positive approaches. Well, in the negotiations rooms, while they're mentioned in the text in a few places as things to explore, this was a non-issue, to be honest, because the issues are much, I would say, more structural and deeper and at much larger scales.
Now, there is a strong push at COP16 to reduce financing of biodiversity harming activities. So what are some practical steps for investors to align their portfolio with the Kunming Montreal targets, and particularly around biodiversity impact measurement and risk management?
Given how things finished, I think this can give, you know, positive and negative signals. Or one could see it this way. I would say that, you know, the negative signals could be, you know, wow, you know, this is a mess. This is a mess. The, you know, we're talking about implementation, but governments are not even able to complete the agenda of conversation that they gave themselves. But I think that this would be, you know, short-sighted. So this is the moment, I think, that in which investors need to do their part and position themselves as a force for good, if they really believe they are, because they don't need to wait that NBSAPS are put in place, for example. We have the Kunming Montreal Framework that sets the direction, and everybody at the level of their organization can have a reading of that. And with just a little bit of effort, they can understand how to translate that into their models. On the DSI, the digital sequence information, it will be possible to track also which companies are really, you know, transparent on their use of genetic resources, which is contributing or not. So it's gonna also be, you know, a way to track where you want to invest or not, if you are serious about these criteria of, you know, biodiversity dependence and impact, but also criteria of social justice, because you want to invest in players that are indeed not behaving as pirates, but who are giving back a fair share to local communities.
Following up on my previous question, access to reliable data on biodiversity is critical for asset managers. So have there been any discussions or announcements at the COP16 around improving biodiversity data and the accessibility for investors?
There's a lot of data available, lots of metrics that are available that can enable to do a good job already without it being perfect. The COP16 did not manage to wrap up some elements of accountability, but this will arrive soon. In 6 months, a few months more or less, when the closing of the COP will happen, all the decisions will be made, and there's already sufficient work in the draft documents on the remaining metrics that had to be adopted, that can be used to, you know, to complete the toolbox and see where, in which direction public authorities will go on these issues.
Thank you so much, Aleksandar, for sharing your insights with us. It's been a fascinating discussion. As the COP16 is wrapping up, we should remind ourselves that protecting biodiversity is not only about conservation. It's about building a secure and resilient future where economies and ecosystems thrive together.